Welcome to Hillsdale College, and welcome to Firing Line. I'm George Roach, president of Hillsdale, and your moderator for this program. In an earlier program, Hillsdale College presented Mr. William F. Buckley and the Reverend Jesse Jackson, founder and head of PUSH, People United to Save Humanity, debating the proposition, resolved that the United States refuse recognition to the Palestine Liberation Organization. With Mr. Buckley and Reverend Jackson, we are pleased to have with us the Honorable Paul Findley, a Republican congressman from the 20th District of Illinois, the Honorable Stephen Solarz, a Democratic congressman from New York's 13th District and the chairman of the House Subcommittee on African Affairs, Mr. Abdeen Jabara, attorney and co-chairman of the Palestinian Human Rights Campaign, Professor Alan Weinstein, member of the History Department at Smith College and author of the recent book, Perjury, the Hiss Chambers Case, Mr. John Cooley, defense correspondent for the Christian Science Monitor, Mr. Thomas Johnson, minority affairs reporter for the New York Times, Dr. Russell Kirk, distinguished author and critic, and Mr. Michael Ledeen, executive director of the Washington Quarterly. The issues developed in the first half of this debate centered on several points. First, the question of terrorism played a prominent part in the discussion. The allegations of and discussion of terrorism as regards PLO activity on the part of those opposing recognition of the PLO was countered by Reverend Jackson and his colleagues by the suggestion that terrorism exists on all sides in the world today and in fact is not a legitimate grounds for judging a given organization. On the other hand, Mr. Jackson and his colleagues suggested that the Palestinian Liberation Organization was a government in exile and as such was representative of the Palestinian people as a whole, to which Mr. Buckley and his associates replied that the PLO, in fact, was unrepresentative of the multiple Palestinian constituencies which actually exist and was a highly vocal, highly violent splinter group than representative of the Palestinian people as a whole. Finally, the central issue, I think, that was raised had to do with the claim on the part of Reverend Jackson and his associates that the recognition of the PLO would normalize ties with the Arab world and thereby relieve a dangerous situation which threatens world peace and, in fact, would thereby promote world peace, to which Mr. Buckley and his colleagues responded that the Palestinian Liberation Organization, among other things, demands virtual extinction of Israel in its the formal position that it's adopted, and they felt this would not, in all probability, be a furtherance of world peace. Both sides, in fact, have agreed, as I think is the basis of all good debates, to disagree. And now that we've decided to disagree, we'll continue that disagreement, I have a feeling, and we'll begin by going back once again to our principal speakers, Mr. Buckley and Reverend Jackson, who will have an opportunity now to question one another. First, Mr. Buckley will question Reverend Jackson, then we will reverse the situation. Gentlemen.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jackson, I have 8 minutes. And during those 8 minutes, I'm going to stick to a single theme in anticipation of asking Mr. Jackson, if necessary, two or three times to answer a very simple question. Let me first of all comment on his extraordinary suggestion that our failure to recognize PLO is a result of some misbegotten creation of Henry Kissinger, who in his imagination continues to dominate American diplomacy. He will have to extend that domination to the domination of the diplomacy of Great Britain, which hasn't recognized PLO, Italy, which hasn't, West Germany, which hasn't. No country in Western Europe has recognized the PLO. In fact, the Soviet Union didn't until 1974. In fact, the United Nations didn't until 1974, even though the PLO was founded in 1964. Now, I'm going to ask Mr. Jackson first, starting at the other end. If you, sir, believed in your heart that the PLO would never recognize the existence of Israel and its right to nationhood, would you then advocate the recognition of the PLO?
No.
Okay. Now, let me ask you this.
Well, you're the host, but I'm the guest. You asked that question specifically, and the technical legal answer was that they do not recognize us, we do not recognize each other. I went a step further, and I said, but you ought to affirm your position. They say our real agenda is a Palestinian state. And they said, furthermore, East and West Germany were next to each other 20 years and didn't recognize each other. They just accepted each other's existence. That is fundamentally where they are now.
Okay, now I don't doubt that you believe this, because I don't doubt that you believe anything you say. But Farouk Kaddoumi, who is the political chief of the PLO, and presumably knows at least as much about his organization as you do, he said, quote, the PLO will never recognize Israel, even if Israel recognizes the PLO. So what do we do about Mr. Kaddoumi?
Well, I think that the majority of that body's conduct will prevail and will be based upon what its live political options are. For example, when they made their adjustment in 1973, there were elements that did not want to settle for focusing on a Palestinian state. There were those who said we should forever keep the position, everybody go back to Palestine in a democratic, secular state, one man, one vote. But after much debate and a democratic confrontation, the position shifted so that that one position stated by someone other than the chairman is not adequate enough to characterize their total position.
Okay, let's take Yasser Arafat then. Quote, our people will continue to fuel the torch of the revolution with rivers of blood until the whole of the occupied homeland is liberated, not just a part. Was he fooling? Was he winking when he said that? Was he saying, don't believe me? Jesse Jackson knows that I really don't mean it.
But you know, I think at that point you must separate his rhetoric from his reality. For by being asked the same question in another way, will you recognize Israel? He says, how can we not recognize their existence because they have atomic weaponry? And so I think that in the heat of a debate, and that's what it is now, debate as opposed to a negotiation, one hears from the other side the willingness to engage in preemptive strikes, no matter what the U.S. position is, no matter what the U.N. position is, no matter how much it threatens international law, no matter how much it damages Lebanon. So we hear this war talk and acts of war in the state of non-relationship, a state of non-talk.
Well, Mr. Jackson, was there much difference between Hitler's rhetoric and Hitler's reality when he swore that if he came to power, he would persecute the Jews?
No, it was not.
Okay, now why is it, does it follow necessarily, since we proceeded to recognize Hitler, as did the entire world, what makes you think that the PLO, attached as it is, as explicitly as any statement by Hitler, to the proposition that Israel has no right to any territory in that area, what is it that gives you the romantic notion that things are bound to change?
Well, you know, I would like to think that to continually compare every adversary with Hitler, in a real sense, I think puts people in an emotional abyss, perhaps an understandable one, but one that does not allow one to look at new options. I mean, 35 years later, there are new checks and balances in the world. Arafat will never have the ability to do to Israel what Hitler had to do to Jews in Germany.
How do you know?
And I think that the American interest in the Middle East, our intelligence sources and our own strength would not permit that to happen. Plus, in my judgment, there is ample evidence.
Which told us a year ago that Iran was an oasis of tranquility. The same forces?
I missed your point.
I say the same intelligence forces that reassured us a year ago that Iran was an oasis of tranquility.
You know, interestingly enough about Iran is that it is the only other place we've ever used a no-talk policy, because we agreed to the Shah to not talk with his opposition. Therefore, we didn't have intelligence about his opposition. Therefore, we were caught unprepared to deal with the situation.
Well, in the first place, the politician was alive and well in Paris and broadcasting three times a day. And in the second place, there was an elected opposition to the Shah, which actually functioned in Tehran. But do you or do you not believe, Mr. Jackson,
that couldn't have been
that if somebody were
opposition.
To say, I will permit the practice of Christianity in this country when Jesse Jackson gives up his belief in the divinity of Christ, to which your answer would be no, never. I am asking you the question, is it impossible for you to believe that it is a doctrinal commitment of the PLO that Israel shall never exist?
I do not believe that.
I know you don't, but why shouldn't you believe it?
And in part I don't believe it because of the number of Christian members of the Executive Council who are operating members, the number of Jewish people with whom they relate. One would not get the impression upon talking with them and looking at their constituency, in part being Christian and Islamic and Jewish, in fact, that you have here a kind of Ayatollah doctrinaire position with which you are competing.
I like old Joe, said Harry Truman, before he found out that 35 million people were being killed by old Joe. If you're saying that the fate of Middle East ought to depend on your personal impressions of the malleability of these people, forgive me if I say that however persuasive you are, in fact, you've accomplished nothing yet. You haven't caused them to retreat one iota from their declared principles to which they are bound by their documents, by their reiterated pronouncements, but you sit here and tell us, recognize the PLO, and the PLO will change. Did the Soviet Union change because we recognized them in 1933? Did China change as a result of our recognition? It is one thing to have contacts, but why is it that you insist that the PLO's position on Israel is simply an affectation?
Because, you
Mr.
know,
Buckley,
people do change. You know, the same Sadat that led a war in 73 and said never as regards recognizing Israel, and the same Begin who said the same thing.
To say that people change doesn't mean that everybody changes.
Because they talked. I mean, the same two adversaries that...
Gentlemen, we have the same two adversaries here with us today.
Because they talked, changed their minds.
I'm going to ask you to invert your positions now for just a moment and question in the other direction. In fact, continue the same question if you choose, but we're beginning now the second period.
I'll let the part of my answer be the beginning of the question because it's important that I fundamentally believe that under the proper set of circumstances, people do change. And Sadat's alteration of his position is evidence that people change. And if we had had a no-talk policy between Israel, America, and Egypt, what is now regarded as the great step forward, Camp David, could not have happened unless President Carter had not walked and talked and offered economic, political, and military security to bind their wounds. Now, on my questions, I was simply responding to your question and giving you a break by asking you fewer questions.
Given what?
In an article that you wrote August 21st, 1979, you said that the Israelis engaged in systematic terrorism in order to midwife the state of Israel. Did you mean to say that? And if so, give some examples of that systematic terrorism.
Well, there is no question that Begin and that the Irgun did exactly that. But here's an interesting difference. They were denounced by all responsible leaders of the Israel state. They were denounced by Ben-Gurion. They were denounced by Golda Meir. They were denounced by the Jewish Agency. In fact, Begin was an outlaw. There was actually an effort to apprehend him and imprison him. I would like to see the PLO put out the same charter on Arafat.
Well, one would have to suggest that it almost comes down to rhetoric if their denunciation eventually led to his being the premier head of the state. It comes out in Rabin's book now. I might add a book that in part where they tried to delete pages and censor it, that they were ordered, not only Mr. Begin, but Rabin and others were ordered to terrorize. And I thought that since you are literate that you would know that and would say that. My second question.
Now, wait a minute. Are we talking about my literacy?
Well, that's a part of it. That's a part of it, because I thought that you would use...
Maybe
this
that
was
too
in
will
one
change.
Of, this was in one of your columns, which is an expression of literacy, and I'm simply trying to deal with that. Secondly...
What happened to the first
do
one?
Do you think... the U.S. press has presented fairly both sides of the debate on the Palestinian-Israeli issue?
I think that there is a definite sentimental attachment to the Israeli nation, which grows out of a collective sympathy by the American people for the Holocaust, even as I think that there was a collective sympathy by the overwhelming members of the press for the civil rights movement 10 years earlier.
And you translate that sympathy to mean a biased coverage of Middle East affairs?
No, I know of no conscious suppression of any fact.
It is
true that when the Arabs raised the price of oil by 400%, the United States' position on Israel did not alter at all. So one must assume that there is a felt position in America that we have a kind of a godfatherly position towards that state. I acknowledge that.
But the one that raised the price of oil was not an Arab state, it was Iran, and Iran is not an Arab state. It was the Shah that raised the price of oil to satiate his greed.
Right.
Indeed, and I think it wouldn't be fair to suggest that the Arab states raised the price of oil when in fact the Shah kicked that off.
Yes,
I think it would be fairer to say, you know, this is my time to take the lead, just be cool.
But what was your question, Mr. Jackson?
Are you aware of the fact that the market price for oil is $28 a barrel, but Saudi Arabia is selling it to America at $18 a barrel, and therefore subsidizing us at $9.5 million a day?
Well, I think that's the friendliest thing you said all night about Saudi Arabia. It is absolutely true that Iran kicked off the price, it and Venezuela, but it is also true that Saudi Arabia was the first country, 2 weeks later, that attempted to use that into a political instrument, refusing, will you remember, to deliver any oil to Holland because Holland hadn't been propitiatory enough during the 1973 war. So Iran was simply trying to get more money, but the Saudis were attempting to use it as a political instrument.
Well, people use the sum total of their resources to realize their interest.
We don't.
And that is logical.
We don't.
Well, that is because we are bound and gagged and can't talk and can't act and we're being irrational.
Who's gotten in your way of free speech lately? Who has stood in the way of your free speech lately? You say you're gagged?
No, the government is gagged, which is the tragedy of it all, because we cannot represent our position, and that is why we are trapped in an unprecedented no-talk policy. I happen to think, in
this
wise bill,
that
our inability to talk reduces our ability to protect our interests in Israel particularly, as well as our position in the Middle East generally. Another question.
Another question.
Which boundaries does Israel recognize? They understand that there are four sets that are talked about. Which boundaries do they recognize?
After 4 months of negotiation, Resolution 242 was voted for by Israel, but has never been sanctioned by the PLO. And the contents of 242...
Why would you wait for someone you don't recognize to sanction anything?
What'd you say?
That was kind of clear, Bill. Why would you wait for someone you don't recognize to sanction anything? The UN that is respected for its 48 petition boundaries is disrespected in its appeal to honor the boundaries.
The PLO does not need to be recognized in order to make its declarations. It's been making them since 1964.
But I'm not speaking about the PLO.
Which is
before
anybody recognized them.
Well, why?
So there's no reason why they can't declare themselves on Resolution 242, which they have failed to do.
If Israel will not recognize the 242 boundaries, and America will not enforce the 242 boundaries, what is the basis for the group that's not talked with to recognize the 242 boundaries?
Well, you were the first person to acknowledge the progress made between Sadat Israel. That is progress that was made as a result of negotiation under a certain umbrella given by the United States, with certain commitments made by the United States. Why isn't the PLO welcoming that kind of reconciliation? Why aren't the Jordanians coming in and welcoming that kind of organization? Why is it that somebody, a Palestinian head who sanctioned and applauded that reconciliation was killed by a PLO terrorist?
Their answer is that that negotiation did not recognize their right to self-determination. But the question I'm asking you, since I'm doing interrogating...
I'm not sure who's asking whom the questions here as I've been watching this proceed in both directions.
Dialogue. My point is, simple as I close, that there are four sets of boundaries there. The 48 boundaries, the 67 boundaries, the biblical boundaries. Which boundaries ought to be honored?
Well, it depends on how frequently you go to war. It took us 25 years to give Okinawa back to Japan because there was a thing called Pearl Harbor. There was a thing called the 1967 war in which the life of Israel was very nearly extinguished. It won that war. It is looking after its security. And I think that Israel ought not to be considered sort of queer for being concerned about its security. I wish we looked after our own more ardently.
I must interrupt now, Reverend Jackson, Mr. Buckley. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
We are also fortunate to have with us two distinguished congressmen to speak on this resolution. The Honorable Stephen Solarz, who is a Democratic congressman from New York's 13th District and is chairman of the House Subcommittee on African Affairs, and the Honorable Paul Findley, who is a Republican congressman from Illinois' 20th District. First, Congressman Solarz will speak in support of Mr. Buckley's position. Congressman?
Mr. President, after listening to Reverend Jackson and my very good friend, Congressman Findley, whom I heard on the way out here, I am reminded of a statement which was made by the philosopher Hegel, who once said that if theory and fact disagree, so much the worse for the facts. What I would like to do this evening is to try to cut through the conflicting claims and contentions on each side of this debate and to suggest that there are three main reasons why it would not be in our interest to recognize the Palestine Liberation Organization. First, because I think that terrorism is compatible with neither our principles nor our purposes. We do, after all, have a stake in peaceful change. And to suggest, as Reverend Jackson has this evening, that any type of violence is a form of terrorism constitutes a kind of moral myopia. The fact of the matter is that there are laws of war and rules of engagement. In combat, certain types of activities are permitted, but other types of actions are prescribed. You can kill combatants. You can't kill civilians. You can attack military facilities and industrial installations. You can't attack schools and hospitals. And the PLO doesn't attack the Israeli army or Israeli industrial facilities. What the PLO does is to engage in the systematic and cold-blooded and deliberate attack of women, children, athletes, and diplomats. And I would suggest that the PLO is not simply a threat to Israel. It is a threat to innocent civilians all over the world. Over the course of the last decade, the PLO has been responsible for almost 1,000 terrorist actions. Hundreds have been killed, and close to 5,000 have been maimed and wounded. And these attacks, while they mostly take place in Israel itself, have also been conducted in over 25 countries around the world. And among the victims have been dozens of American citizens and at least three American diplomats. I would suggest that as a matter of principle, the United States has consistently and correctly refused to negotiate with terrorists. No responsible American leader that I'm aware of has ever suggested that the United States should recognize the Bader-Meinhof gang, or the Japanese Red Army, or the Symbionese Liberation Army. And I think in those terms that it was a sad day for America when the disciples of the Reverend Martin Luther King went to Beirut and embraced the leader of the Palestine Liberation Organization, Yasser Arafat, a man responsible for the murder of little children and of innocent athletes and women, and sang together, "We shall overcome." To be sure, the Bible says that at the end of the days, the lions and the lambs shall lie down together. But it doesn't say anything about them singing in the same choir. And so I would say that by recognizing the PLO, what we will do is to encourage the kind of atmosphere and activities which resulted a few weeks ago in the seizure of the American embassy in Tehran. Secondly, I would argue that recognizing the PLO will jeopardize the prospects for peace in the Middle East. As my able associates have pointed out, the PLO is clearly and unequivocally committed to the elimination of Israel as a Zionist state in the Middle East. And while it is true that the PLO on occasion has said that it would accept an independent Palestinian state on the West Bank and Gaza, it has made it absolutely clear that it would not be willing, even if it got such a state, to simultaneously recognize Israel's right to exist, but that it is instead determined to use such a state as a base for continuing its war of terror against Israel itself. And what would the establishment of a PLO state on the West Bank and Gaza mean to Israel, given the determination of the PLO to destroy the Israeli presence in the Middle East? It would mean that the PLO would be in a position where Arab anti-aircraft missiles were within range of literally every air base in Israel. It would mean that Arab artillery would be within range of 90% of the population of Israel and 90% of its major industrial facilities. It would mean that Israel would lose critical strategic depth. At some points, the state would only be 9 miles wide. And in the context of another surprise Arab attack against Israel, they would be able to cut Israel in half in literally a matter of minutes. And finally, it would mean that the opportunities for terrorism against the women and the children and the men of Israel would be significantly enhanced, since the border which Israel would have to protect against such terrorist raids would be substantially enlarged. The fact of the matter is that the record of the PLO in the Middle East over the course of the last decade is hardly a record designed to encourage thoughts of moderation in Tel Aviv. In 1970, the PLO provoked and facilitated a civil war in Jordan, which resulted in the death of 4,000 to 5,000 civilians. And in 1976, it helped to provoke a civil war in the Lebanon, which has resulted in the death of over 60,000 Muslims and Christians in that country. And so I would say that no one can reasonably or rightfully expect the Israelis to agree to the establishment of a PLO-dominated state on the West Bank and Gaza, given the PLO's past record in the Middle East and its determination to drive the Israelis into the sea. And finally, I would say that it's not in our interest to recognize the PLO because the United States, rightly or wrongly, has made a solemn commitment to Israel in 1975, which it reaffirmed in 1979, not to recognize the PLO. In exchange for this commitment, in the context of the second stage disengagement in the Sinai, the Israelis agreed to return to Egypt the oil wells at Abu Rodeis and the critically and strategically significant passes in the Sinai as well. And it's absolutely clear that Israel wouldn't have been willing to make those concessions if we hadn't been willing to give them that commitment. Now, I would suggest that in light of those facts, if we blithely and unilaterally repudiate the commitment which we made to Israel not to recognize the PLO unless and until the PLO accepts UN Resolution 242 and Israel's right to exist, that two things would happen. First, our allies elsewhere in the world would lose faith in the credibility of our commitments to them. And to the extent that our security depends on the willingness of our allies in Western Europe and Japan to rely on the credibility of the American deterrent, I think it would undermine the security of our own nation.
But Congressman Solarz, I'm a bit past on time.
I'll just finish in 30 seconds. And secondly, and perhaps most importantly, to the extent that a comprehensive peace in the Middle East will require the Arabs to agree to live in peace with Israel, but will also require Israel to make additional political and territorial concessions to the Arabs, it's absolutely clear that Israel's willingness to make those concessions, given the extent to which it will, by definition, put them in a less defensible position in the future than they are at the present, will depend on their faith in the willingness of the United States to come to their defense and to live up to its commitments. And if we blithely and unilaterally repudiate a solemn commitment we made to them in 1975, the Israelis will lose faith in the credibility of our commitments, and the prospects for peace in the Middle East will have been diminished in the process.
Thank you very much. Next, Congressman Findley will speak in support of Mr. Jackson's position.
Mr. Buckley, Reverend Jackson, my colleague Steve Solarz, and other panelists, Mr. President, I have a heavy burden tonight. I have to convey to you somehow why it is that an obscure Republican from the Midwest who hasn't one Palestinian constituent in his entire district and has an enormous number of very influential Jewish constituents would nevertheless be arguing that the United States interest would be best served by recognizing the Palestine Liberation Organization. And you've heard a very eloquent plea from Steve Solarz, and I must say, and I say this with no unkindness whatever, Steve, you have made the same speech a year ago and 2 years ago and a year before that, and I have heard it each time and I've admired your eloquence, but it seems to me that the world has not changed one bit in the intervening time, and indeed it has. And as my famous constituent, I like to think of him as my constituent, Abraham Lincoln once said, the occasion is piled high with difficulty. We have to rise with the occasion. We have to act anew and think anew, and I think that's what we have to do tonight. The Middle East is a time bomb that may explode again in almost any direction. And like it or not, the United States has deep interests it must protect in that region. The root problem in the Middle East, and I don't think anyone would deny it, is the Palestinian problem, a problem that we will not wither away no matter how much we may castigate the Palestinians for past misdeeds. There is no way we can make an end run around it. A comprehensive peace in the Middle East that will enable all parties to get out from under this enormous burden of war must deal with the Palestinian problem. And yet all we seem to do as a nation is to describe the Palestinian people and their representatives, the PLO, as nothing but a band of terrorists. I say we should recognize the PLO out of the interest of the United States, but also out of the interest of the State of Israel as well. Now, what does recognition mean? It really doesn't mean building an embassy in Beirut at the Arab University or wherever Mr. Arafat holds forth. It doesn't mean exchanging with all their grandeur ambassadors. What it means, at least I hesitate to cite the State Department, but this is what the State Department regards as recognition, it means that we accept as valid the claim of the PLO to be the sole representative of the Palestinian people. That's all recognition means. Now, I was delighted to hear that Mr. Buckley, a man whom I admire very much, is for talking with the PLO. That's an enormous advance from the position that I think my colleague Steve Solarz holds. It certainly is an enormous advance from the position of our administration. Now, who can challenge that the PLO is the legitimate, the sole recognized representative of the Palestinian people. Well, they don't have many elections, that's true. A refugee lot has difficulty holding elections. But in 1976, elections were held in the West Bank, and almost everyone elected was a pro-PLO candidate. No informed source that I can find believes there is any other PLO leadership waiting in the wings, ready to spring into action with the disappearance of the PLO. There is none. The PLO is more united today, more unified, more committed than ever before in the past. Now, the only challenge to the PLO leadership today, and it's not a serious challenge, comes from the more radical wing within the movement itself. We can't decide who will represent the Palestinians. We must decide whether or not it is in our nation's interest, it is in our nation's interest to deal with the Palestinian movement. Now, why should we recognize the PLO? Palestinians are people. They're human beings. The U.S. has high stakes in a peaceful, stable, just settlement in that region. We seek to influence the behavior of the Palestinian people. There is only one agency of the Palestinian people, and that's the PLO. If we seek to influence the behavior of the Palestinian people, why don't we begin to talk with them? What could be more logical? Well, I think we have another good reason. Our society is committed to the free exchange of ideas. We believe in the First Amendment. We believe in talking with each other, examining each other's ideas as we are here tonight. It's difficult for me to reconcile the blind, head-in-the-sand policy of our administration. In refusing to talk with the PLO, it's difficult for me to reconcile that with the great traditions of our open society.
30 seconds, please, Congressman.
The free exchange of ideas.
30 seconds, please.
I'm troubled by what I've heard tonight because there seems to be no willingness to deal with the root problem of the Middle East. Why not talk? Why not communicate as a way to influence behavior and break this cycle of violence? As the ancient prophet Ecclesiastes said, surely there is a time to talk, a time for peace. And I believe it's up to the United States to begin that time to talk in order to usher in that opportunity for peace.
Thank you, Congressman Findley. And now we will turn to our panel of distinguished journalists to question the debaters. I would like to ask the participants to please limit themselves to moderately short answers. This, I think, will permit time for more questions than would otherwise be the case. And we'll begin with Dr. Russell Kirk, distinguished author and critic. Dr. Kirk, have you a question?
Yes, sir. I address my question to Representative Findley. Congressman Findley, you've remarked, in effect, that diplomatic recognition is a matter of practical statecraft. Now, in that connection, the government of the United States extends recognition to other governments which fulfill certain requirements. Among those requirements are sovereign possession of a permanent territory, a reasonably stable order, and the government in question being amenable to the ordinary operation of international law. Recognition is not accorded by the United States merely to armed bands which aspire to power. Now, my question in substance is this. Do you hold that the Palestine Liberation Organization meets these requirements of recognition? And if you so hold, are not those requirements also met by, let us say, the Irish Republican Army in Northern Ireland, by the Polisario Front in what used to be the Spanish Sahara, by the Muslim separatists in the southern Philippines, or by the remnants of Idi Amin's forces in Uganda?
Mr. Kirk, I'm sure that you heard, as I did, Reverend Jackson's very complete explanation of the character of the PLO, showing that it is far more than a band of terrorists bent only on violence. Now, to be sure, it is hardly a government, and it seems to me that what you have cited as the standards for recognition are the standards that would need apply where governments are concerned. Now, it's difficult for me to reconcile the policy of the administration having a no-talk policy with the PLO and yet actively engaged in negotiations and all kinds of consultation with Nkrumah, Mugabe, the, let's say, terrorist organizations within Rhodesia. Now, I don't fault them for those contacts. I dare say those contacts have served our national interests. And I'm not drawing a parallel between those small roving bands of disorganized revolutionaries with the PLO. It's far different. What I'm trying to show is that this is a broad movement, an enormous, well-organized movement. We ought to deal with it. We ought to recognize that it meets the standards that our diplomatic leaders in the State Department said are sufficient. That is the standard that the standard that they that their claim is valid as the sole representative of the Palestinian people.
Thank you, Congressman. Our next question will be from Mr. Thomas Johnson of the New York Times. Mr. Johnson?
Yes, Congressman Solarz. Earlier this month, the New York Times CBS News poll concluded that 42% of the American people who had heard of the PLO felt that the United States should negotiate with that organization despite the objections of Israel. In addition, the European Common Market issued a statement quite recently saying that the PLO must be involved in any peacemaking process in that region. Add to that a meeting in Detroit 2 weeks ago, 500 black American clergymen representing seven Christian denominations, perhaps 10 to 15 million people, they went even further. Question, were these people duped? One question. Another, is there a danger in the Israeli position of that nation becoming even more isolated in the world community now by this hard line on the PLO? And can American interests suffer given the historic American commitment, the historic and strong American commitment to Israel?
Well, let me say, first of all, Mr. Johnson, that I have confidence that if such a poll is taken after this debate appears on television, that the results might be somewhat different. Because I think if the American people were aware, as I suspect many of them who were asked these questions in the survey were not, that their country, in 1975, had made a solemn commitment to Israel, reaffirmed in 1979, not to recognize the PLO unless and until the PLO accepts UN Resolution 242 and Israel's right to exist, that a great majority of them would come to the conclusion that it would not be appropriate or seemly for the United States to unilaterally and blithely repudiate solemn commitments which it has made to other countries, as a consequence of which that country, in this case Israel, has made very significant strategic and economic concessions.
Congressman, we're at the point now where I must interrupt the questions and turn to the summary from our principals here. First, Reverend Jackson will be speaking, and then Mr. Buckley. I ask in this case that we adhere quite literally to the six-minute limit to get everything in the program, and I'll bang the gavel hard at the end. All right. please.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank you, Mr. President, and the sponsors of this dialogue, of this debate, for allowing it to be so. For I really think that a platform whereby Palestinians and Jews, Republicans and Democrats, black and white people can, in a civilized fashion, discuss a critical issue is the best way to instruct and to educate the American public. I would suggest, Mr. Johnson, that the LA Times poll went a step further. It said that 42% of the American Jews, 63% of the American blacks, 66% of the Catholics before the Pope took his position, and 2/3 of the American public think that we should talk with the PLO. It is not an isolated position. I want to establish one fact tonight, and that is that to argue this case, from my personal point of view, is not to be anti-Semitic or anti-Jewish. It is a pro-peace position. I think Israel's present strategy is not in Israel's best interest, and in fact, helps to jeopardize America's own interests. I want to deal with your points, Mr. Congressman, because I think it's instructive. On terrorism, I visited hospitals in Israel where Israeli children had been terrorized and had been maimed. It was a horrible sight. But I also went to Lebanon and I saw children had been killed, schools had been bombed, churches had been bombed by Israelis. And that is why I said, by experience, I have seen terror on both sides. And simply to reiterate, yesterday's agony will not, in fact, bring about the peace we need for tomorrow. In a real sense, who sets the rules of war? Our nation bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We said we were sorry, but we did it. And people in desperation fighting for war, people tend to set wars, they set methods that win. In one of Mr. Buckley's columns, he referred to the fact that usually the group that wins and prevails is end up justifying an end. I do not accept all means, except I recognize them to be what they are, acts of horrible war. The Apostle Paul was a terrorist, but he was transformed through talking. Begging, no matter how much he was denounced, was not permanently outlawed. He received the ultimate reward, and he did not get recognized as a musician or a chemist, but his chief item in his portfolio is that of a terrorist who became a politician who represents a hard line to the right. Secondly, America does in fact recognize terrorist governments. South Africa, Chile, Iran, when it had the worst record by Amnesty International in the Western world, Nicaragua on the Somoza. Mr. Sadat, that we respect now, recognizes the PLO. He appealed to Israel to recognize the PLO, and the PLO could recognize Israel. He even appealed in our talks for America to recognize the PLO. On 242, Israel is not honoring 242. America is not enforcing 242. The PLO is not recognizing 242. I would argue that the biggest and the most moral of the three will take the first step. Maybe the strongest of the three will take the first step. My appeal, lastly, is that if we move beyond debate and upsmanship, that somewhere, somehow, somebody got to trust somebody. We could not prove that Mr. Sadat will maintain the position the Israel he now has, but we've learned to trust him. He could not prove that Mr. Begin will not change his mind, but somehow trust has been established. And trust must be the foundation to move from war to peace. I would hope that throughout this nation that debates like this will occur on college campuses with Iranian students, Arabs, Jews, blacks, and whites, and use the process of debate and controversy to be a way of public education. Again, I'm grateful for having had the opportunity to engage in this dialogue and look forward around the nation to heightening the dialogue and hope that in our lifetime, in the immediate future, that our nation will have assumed a talk policy that will allow us to reconcile our four critical interests: protection of Israel's right to exist within internationally recognized boundaries, Palestinian justice, the territorial integrity of Lebanon and normalize ties with the Arab world. I think it's possible. I think we must pursue it. Thank you very much.
Jackson, I think we should recognize what is the nature of what it is that we're being asked to do. We're being asked to deny a commitment by two governments of the United States, just to begin with. We are also being asked to forget a commitment which is shared by the community of nations at large. It's a commitment to the right of Israel to survive. Why does the PLO refuse to give us that reassurance? It seems to me that if it is correct, as Mr. Jackson so eloquently argues and Mr. Findley, that so much would be furthered by our recognizing the PLO, then the PLO would recognize that it would be not much to exchange for that recognition to acknowledge that commitment which the whole community of nations feels towards the survival of Israel. This is what I think we should look at with especial care. Why do they refuse? The reason they refuse is because the PLO is dedicated to the abolition of the state. How can we enhance the prospects of peace by enhancing the fortunes of an organization that is dedicated to prolonging war? If the PLO indeed wants peace in the area, if it wants justice in the area, it has got to be prepared to do one very simple thing. It could do it tonight, and tomorrow everybody here would be in favor of recognizing the PLO. Just one simple thing. We acknowledge your right to exist. In international transactions, as in certain human transactions, certain rights aren't barterable, as Professor Russell Kirk suggested. The right of a nation to exist comes before all other considerations. We are being asked to consider, as the legitimate government of 4 million people who have never, in fact, voted to authenticate that government, we are being asked to recognize as its government, an organization known throughout the world, proud for its lapidary declarations that the state of Israel shall not survive. If indeed there is some sacramental difference between talking to a state and recognizing it, then it is that sacramental difference that we are here to discuss. Because nobody denies that in fact we have conversations with Arafat. We had them in Austria, authorized under the circumstances. But it is that recognition that makes a difference. And the moment we recognize, we put ourselves in the position of acknowledging, at least as debatable, the survival of the State of Israel. Jesse Jackson spoke rather philosophically and quoted my saying that the guy who wins turns out to be recognized, and before long he comes, he's invited to the 4th of July celebrations. And that's true. This is the century in which we recognize Adolf Hitler, and the century in which we recognize Stalin, people indeed who were worse than Nicaraguans and Chileans that Mr. Jackson sought for some reason to identify to the exclusion of others. We fought in the United Nations to recognize the legitimacy of Pol Pot. We recognize the Emperor Bokassa and Idi Amin. But we recognize them because they were de facto governors of a particular territory, and we didn't have much opportunity to go in a different direction, but now we do. In the case of the PLO, we ask just one thing. Grant us that which makes peace possible in this area of the world. Don't come to us as though you had the credentials of a de facto government, because you don't. You are not a de facto government. Show us that you really want to exchange the barter of diplomacy. Show us that you are not devoted to saturating Palestine with Jewish blood, one of their terms, not my own. Prove to us that there has been the same kind of change that we saw in Sadat, who went to Tel Aviv and bowed his head there and said in front of the people with whom he had fought, "I renounce my past." Yes, Mr. Jackson, people can change. Sadat has changed. People can change, but sometimes people don't change. And when people don't change, when they are obstinate after the fashion of the Ayatollah, then we simply increase our misery, increase our disadvantage, and in the course of doing so, in the current instance, dishonor our sacred word.
Thank you, Reverend Jackson, Mr. Buckley, and all our participants. This concludes the debate on the recognition of the Palestine Liberation Organization in keeping with the Hillsdale College independent policy of presenting the finest commentators on today's major policy issues. It has been our pleasure to be with you. And for now, goodbye.
Bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations. Thank you.